Please join me in the call to worship. Happy are those who take delight in the law of the Lord. They are like trees planted by streams of water, and all that they do prosper. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous. May God number us with the righteous as we worship the Lord. Let us worship God. Let us pray. We seek to dwell in your presence, O God, and behold evermore the warmth of your love. For you shelter your people during their time of adversity. You cradle them in your arms when they are afraid and lonely. You beckon us to embrace you and to put an end to our fearfulness. Entering your sanctuary, we give you praise for your mercy. Be pleased with our worship as we honor your name. Amen. First hymn is Come Thou Almighty King, number 8. Please join me in the prayer of confession. All wise and understanding God, hear our prayer as we confess our sin. Have mercy upon us, for we are deceitful and foolish. Ambition controls our relations with others. Cheating and lying help us gain more control. We are surrounded by values that bring disorder. We are victims of selfishness that distorts your truth. Save us from boasting and serving unworthy ends. Save us for Christ, whom alone abides peace. Hear the good news. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of the cross. In the peace that Christ won abides our assurance of pardon. Amen. The peace of God be with you. Greet one another in peace.
Thank you. Come on down. I see a handful of kids. Come on down. Well, good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Robert. Hiding over there. I brought with me today something that I bet all of you are familiar with. What is this? It's a baby bottle. That's right. It's a baby bottle. Good morning. Good morning, Miss. It's Evelyn hanging on a mama. Good morning. I brought with me today a baby bottle. A baby bottle. So what would baby bottle be used for then? What, Eli, what do we use that for? So if I have a baby with me today and I just hand them this bottle, is all good? I got to feed it? Well, what can I just give it to them like this with this piece of paper in it? No, what do I need to do to feed the baby? What do I need to do, Cameron? That's a lot of steps. So the baby can't do that themselves, can they? So who has to do that? Yeah, a mom or a dad or an adult or a babysitter. Somebody has to put the food in here and then hold the baby and feed it to them, right? Because the baby can't do this themselves. Can't do that. What about you guys? Are there a lot of things you can't do yourself yet? Like, what if your mom and dad just said, you know what, we're moving out and you're staying here? Could you take care of the house and pay the bills? And no, it'd be kind of tough, wouldn't it? You couldn't drive the car and get to school and all that stuff, could you? You know, the food's going to run out eventually. There's only so much you can microwave. Yeah, it's going to run out. So all of us at some point in time need people. We need people to help us. We need our family to help us, just like that baby needs this bottle. Well, in the Bible today, Jesus talks about children, and he says, you need to be like a child when you come to Jesus. You're like, what does that mean? Does that mean I have to go gaga goo goo when I come to Jesus? No. It means you need to come to Jesus recognizing that there are a lot of things you can't do on your own, that you need Jesus for those things. There are lots of things you can't do on your own. There are things we need Jesus for, such as teaching us about love, giving us forgiveness. And we learn, too, that just like you all need a family and the baby needs somebody to take care of him and love him, we need a family. And that's what the church is. The church is our family. And we come here and we help one another. And those of us who have been in the church a lot longer teach Sunday school. Those who have grown up in the church, maybe they're leaders in the church, but we need each other to nurture each other and to learn from each other. So when we come before God, we remember that we come as a child, not immature and crawling on the floor, but we come before God recognizing that we have needs that only He is capable of providing. And that's what Jesus is telling us in that verse, is be like a little child and recognize your dependence on God and on your church family. Let us pray. God, we are so grateful that we don't run through this life alone, but that rather you have given us a whole host of people to love us, to care for us, and to show us the way. We thank you for these people and ask, Lord, that as we continue to grow, that we learn to be leaders as well. In your name we pray. Amen. I'd like to invite you to Sunday school.
Our hymn is number 553, Near My God to Thee.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our New Testament lesson today comes from James chapter 3, starting at verse 13. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness, born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and you do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, starting at verse 30. Then they went on from there and passed from Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they didn't understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down and called the 12 and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I believe it was after fifth grade in the summer, we went to visit my paternal grandparents. Now, my grandfather in the summer loved to sit out on the porch. He loved to watch the sun go down. He loved to listen to the sounds of summer and the sounds of the farm. And yes, he enjoyed drinking a beer. You could tell that this was his time to unwind and to relax. And he was a lot more jovial during this time than he was at any other time of the day, especially if he was trying to get something done. So I was sitting out there on the porch with him as I had done at other times. I noticed that he now had hearing aids. Obviously, his hearing had deteriorated to the point where he needed hearing aids. But as I was sitting out on that porch, I would hear first grandmother and some other people yell at him at the porch when he was sitting out on the porch, but he didn't seem to hear them. So that, well, maybe the hearing aids weren't perfect, or maybe his hearing was so bad that it couldn't be completely restored. And that's what I thought until a couple days later I heard my grandmother grumbling that he seemed to be able to hear some things, but he wasn't able to hear other things. She was clearly accusing my grandfather of having selective hearing. And a little bit later I heard my aunt say the same thing. They both pointed out when he's sitting out on that porch at night, it's amazing what he can hear and it's amazing what he can't hear. Selective hearing. We all have it as human beings. We hear the things we want to hear, and we do not hear the things we do not want to hear. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus tells the apostles yet again that he is going to be betrayed and that he is going to die, and on the third day he is going to rise from the dead. But it tells us they didn't understand and they were afraid to ask him. As our gospel lesson goes on, the apostles are arguing on the way as they're making their way to Capernaum. Now, they don't think Jesus hears them. And so when they get in the evening, Jesus has allowed them to go through this entire argument. And then he asks them, what were you arguing about on the way? And of course, they're completely silent because they know they shouldn't be arguing about who was the greatest. And so Jesus takes a child and sets it among them to remind them if they want to be great, they must be last of all and servant of all. As we read our gospel lesson today, it's sometimes hard to understand why Jesus would have chosen these individuals. Why choose individuals who cannot understand the plain, simple message that he was telling them, that he was going to die, he was going to be betrayed and die, and then on the third day, rise from the dead? Why choose these apostles who were constantly arguing among each other about who was the greatest? Because this is not the only time it happens in Scripture. And it even happened as late as the Last Supper itself. They were arguing about which one of them was the number one apostle. It's easy to read these stories of the apostles and see as they bumble and stumble around in the Gospels and wonder why in the world would Jesus ever pick them? And why in the world would we be arguing about who was the greatest? Well, I think we have to understand a little bit from the apostles' perspective. First of all, why were they arguing about which of them was the greatest? Imagine for an instant that you're chosen for a special task. You are one of 12 people out of a whole nation that is chosen for a particular task. And it's not just that you're chosen for this particular task. You get access to the one individual that everybody else wants access to. 24/7, you're allowed to be with Jesus when everyone else's access to Jesus is restricted, if they get any access at all, that is. Not only that, but Jesus is constantly giving you teachings that he's telling no one else. And Jesus himself tells you that he is giving you the very secrets of the kingdom of God. Imagine being chosen for such a position. Imagine getting all that special attention. Imagine getting all those teachings. Imagine hearing that you have received the secrets to the kingdom of God. You might just feel a little bit special. You might just start to feel like you're a little bit better than everyone else, especially the crowd who is following Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. We know in our gospel lessons that Jesus has already sent out the 12 on their mission. He gave them the Holy Spirit, and he has sent them out, and he gave them power to heal the sick and to drive out evil demons and evil spirits. He has given them, through the power of God and the power of the Spirit, the ability to have power over all evil. They have been chosen. They have had this special access. They have learned these teachings no one else gets. They have the secrets of the kingdom of God. They've worked miracles like no one else. You might imagine in that situation, a human being might just start to think that they're pretty special, that they've got a lot going for them. And so why not argue about which one of them? They're all great. They know that. They're all great. We're all great. But which one of us is the greatest? Thinking about it from the apostles' perspective, we can probably excuse them for taking the dip in human behavior once in a while, wallowing around in that vat of human nature, which is to want to think that we're special or that we're privileged or that we're better than other people. We can probably understand why the apostles did that from time to time, given their experiences. But how in the world could they consistently miss Jesus' point that he was going to die? How could they miss Jesus' straightforward message that he was going to be betrayed, he was going to be crucified, and on the third day, he was going to rise from the dead? How in the world could they miss that, even though he told them that over and over? In our high school, our sophomore programs, sports programs, were separate from the varsity programs. So when softball or football was going on, I was feeling pretty good about myself competing against other sophomores on the team and other sophomores in other schools. That all changed after the second game of the season when I was told that I would get the honor of suiting up for the varsity. And it did sound like an honor. You got a varsity jersey. None of the other sophomores had it. And you got to eat with the team at the pregame meal at the restaurant. And you got to ride the bus and stand on the sidelines. It did start to sound like it was a little bit of an honor here. But they didn't tell us about the fact we were going to have to participate in pregame warm-ups with the varsity players. And on the first such warm-up and the first such drill, I was lined up not only against a senior, not only against a starter, but someone who was a captain of the team. The coach yelled, "Hut!" I fired off, he fired off, and he literally ran me over. I'm surprised there wasn't a police incident about the whole thing. I don't know how I didn't end up on the ground. Probably he had mercy on me and didn't drive me into the ground. Now, our coaches had been telling us sophomores that if we wanted to play at the varsity level, we needed to get in the weight room and get stronger. I had heard that message and I believed it, but there's a difference between hearing and hearing. The coach wasn't just telling us we need to get in the weight room, especially those of us on the line, and get a little bit stronger, but we needed to put on about 40 more pounds of muscle. And the coach also told us over and over that during the drills, we needed to work hard and to get better. And you hear that, you believe it, but then you realize in an instant, I did, how much better I needed to get. And then again, the coaches tell you about quickness and intensity, and you hear all that, you believe it, but there's a difference between hearing and really hearing. And sometimes there is an incident that brings home that you've been hearing, but you really haven't heard. And so I knew I had a whole lot more work to do. Getting back to the apostles, why didn't they understand when they heard Jesus? It's not like they covered their ears. They heard Jesus when he said he was going to die. They heard him when he said he was going to raise from the dead. How come they heard him, but they didn't understand? We have to remember that the apostles had been taught since they were little. The entire time they grew up, everybody that spoke in the synagogues told them the same story. One day, the Messiah was going to come. And that Messiah eventually was going to make his way to Jerusalem. And then he was going to use the power of God to take over the world. The apostles knew how this story was supposed to end. They knew what was supposed to happen. And when Jesus is talking about dying on the cross, they're probably trying to fit that into their understanding of what's supposed to happen. They're probably thinking he's speaking metaphorically, or he's making some sort of point about making sure you always serve God. But the plain, straightforward meaning that he was going to die and then he was going to raise from the dead, that's something they just couldn't understand, because their whole worldview was telling them that's not what was going to happen to the Messiah, especially when he went into Jerusalem. Also, the apostles didn't understand when Jesus talked to them about being a servant. Why? When Jesus rides into Jerusalem and takes over, using the power of God, the world, they're supposed to be part of his new administration. Because they got in on the ground floor, because they were selected, because they bought that stock at pennies that eventually turned into be a $1 trillion business, because they got in on the ground floor and were accepted by Jesus, they're expecting to sit on thrones and administer this kingdom that God is going to manifest in the world. So when Jesus talks to them about being a servant and being humble, they're thinking about it in terms of, yes, when I sit on my throne one day, I probably should remember to be humble. I should probably remember I'm supposed to be there to help people. That's how they're hearing that. When I sit on my throne, I'll try to be humble. That's how the apostles understood what Jesus was saying. It's why they could hear him but not understand him. But we know all that changed for the apostles. In the twinkling of an eye, in an instant of time, all of that changed. And what was it that caused that change in their lives? What was the thing that happened so that they would never again be the same? It was watching Jesus die on the cross. When Jesus was nailed to the cross, it became clear to them that all their ideas about what was going to happen, well, they came crashing down. They were now dust and ashes. All those ideas they had that Jesus was going to go to Jerusalem and use the power of God to take over the world, that wasn't going to happen. They also learned in watching Jesus die on the cross, a man they knew who was sinless, a man they knew who had the power of God to stop what was happening to him. When they witnessed the individual who could do any miracle and had any power die on the cross, they realized that when Jesus talked about suffering, when he talked about dying to yourself, when he talked about putting others first. Those weren't just metaphorical words. It wasn't just to remind them when they sat on thrones that they're supposed to be helping people. Suddenly, it took on a whole different meaning. Yes, we can see the apostles stumbling and bumbling throughout the Gospels and not understanding Jesus. But in that one moment when they witnessed Jesus die on the cross, everything changed for them. Now, we like the apostles that are bumbling and stumbling around. And if you hear people talk about the apostles, that's most of what they're talking about. How they didn't get it. How they didn't understand. Making fun of them. And there's something there to get at. But isn't it interesting, we don't look so much about the apostles of what happens after Jesus' resurrection. We don't focus in on the apostles so much after Jesus came back and what their lives were like. Because while they may have bumbled and stumbled around in the Gospels, once Jesus died and came back, their lives were completely different. No longer were they arguing about who was the greatest. No longer did they fail to understand that the service Jesus was talking about wasn't sitting on a throne and administering a kingdom. No longer did they have fights among each other, but were a band of brothers serving God, putting all differences and pride and arrogance aside. I find it interesting that when we talk about the apostles, we usually talk about the apostles who aren't getting it and who don't understand. Why is that? Well, sitting back as we do on 2,000 years of church history, we know, of course, the ending of the story. So it's obvious to us how wrong the apostles are. And that is true. But the thing about something is the more familiar you are with something, the more we can take it for granted. The more we can fail to see the value of it. We have 2,000 years to look back on Christ's death. We know the ending of the story. For the apostles, it happened in their very life. But here's a question we should probably ponder rather than thinking about how often the apostles got it wrong, which is we know the ending. We know the story. We know what happened. But have we ever allowed the death of our Lord and Savior to affect us the way that it affected the apostles? Is there a single day in which we have lived where we have let Jesus' death on the cross affect us the way the apostles allowed it to affect them for their entire lives after that point? When is the last time we got up in the morning in a particular day and we had a whole list of things we wanted to do and to accomplish, but instead we took time in prayer and said, God, what is it that you want me to do today? What is it that you want me to accomplish in this day? When is the last time we got up in the morning and we had a whole bunch of things to do, but instead we decided, you know, I'm not going to do any of those things that I want because this person I know who needs my help, and so I'm going to spend my time today helping them. When is the last time we looked at our Savior's death on the cross, the sacrifice he made for us, the example he showed us in laying aside everything to die for us? When is the last time we looked at our Savior's death on the cross and let it affect us even for a single day the way it did for the apostles? Because as much as we want to talk about how bumbling and stumbling they were before Jesus' death and resurrection, as much as we like to chuckle about how they didn't understand, how they misunderstood, how could they not get it, after Jesus' death and resurrection, we have pictures of individuals who gave everything, everything, their whole lives, all that they could become to serve God and to serve other people. After his death and resurrection, we have a picture of the apostles who no longer were arguing with one another, but were forgiving people, even people who were putting them to death, thinking they were doing the right thing. No longer were the apostles confused about life, but they were individuals who had a purpose. When is the last time we allowed the death of Jesus to affect us the way it affected the apostles? Maybe they didn't understand very quickly. Maybe they didn't hear at first. But when they did, boy, did they hear. Boy, did they understand. And maybe we should ask, rather than worrying about the apostles before they didn't get it and before they didn't understand, maybe we should think more about the apostles when they did get it and understand and ask, are we doing the same? Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for your teachings and for calling your people to give us examples and to help us understand how we are to relate to you and to the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Okay, wait a minute. Please be seated. I guess we'll do the Apostles' Creed while we remain seated. Please join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Alrighty. Any announcements that anyone has? Any prayer requests? Okay. Let's gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come and worship you. And we pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us at this time. that we would be drawn closer to you and to one another, as was your purpose when you walked the earth, as was your teaching as you gave it to the apostles, and as they went out and told the world the good news about the relationship you want to have with each one of us. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us and touch us and help us to be your servants, to take up the requests that you have made us in the Gospels, to seek to live according to your teachings, to seek to live as much as we can for the example that you have given us. And we thank you, Lord God, that you promise us that your Spirit will always be with us, even when we don't live as you have asked us to, and even when we don't live according to your example. We thank you that in your mercy and your love, you always put these sins away, and you're always asking us to try again, to learn something new, to go in a different direction, to be blessed by you in some way. We also pray this day, Lord God, for our world. We pray, Lord God, for all those individuals who are going through difficulties and struggles. We also pray, Lord God, for those who are taking upon themselves difficulties and struggles, which they need not do. We pray that your blessing will be with these individuals as you relieve them of their burdens. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Mighty Redeemer, whose judgment is righteous, whose mercy has no bounds, we bring you our offerings in response to your grace. You sent Christ who calls us. We give you commitment. You gave the Spirit to nurture us. We enthusiastically follow. You provide the commandments as guidance. We seek to obey you. Take us and use us to fulfill your will. Amen. Our last hymn's 750, Peace Like a River. Choir favorite. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.